experimenting with containers like everyone else. We've learned some things, but we have a ways to go. And so I would love if I had well-developed own solutions for you today, but I'm afraid that's not the case. But hopefully we can pick something out of it anyway. I certainly have to all the other topics over the last 2 days. So I'm from the University of Melbourne, partner called Research Platform Services, which is kind of a research-oriented, super-professional IP department. By way of background, we have about 4,000 researchers plus affiliated institutes, hospitals, medical research institutes, that kind of thing. We have a research cloud based on OpenStack, which I've come to learn is fairly unusual globally. Last time I checked, there are about 30,000 cores running at the moment. And this is a national federation, so there's data centers in Melbourne and Sydney all across Australia, and they all have a common control fabric through OpenStack. And that's quite handy because you can just throw VMs at researchers or they can create themselves, do whatever they want, and not be tied up by institutional IT. We have the traditional kind of peak HPC facilities, we have quotas and so forth, and we also have a local, small local HPC facility, which I'll talk a bit about in a moment. And this is a little bit unusual in that about two-thirds of the cores for this facility are actually from our OpenStack cloud, so it's not traditional HPC. But we have a group of users who are basically beginners as far as HPC. We have the advanced people as well. There's a lot of Python and MATLAB, kind of single node, embarrassingly parallel jobs, where the imperative is just to get people started quickly rather than pushing them through an application process or something like that. So that's us. The two things I want to talk about today, the first is, are containers a viable alternative for installing software natively on an HPC system, and I'll talk about why we might want to do that and the kind of experiments that I've done so far. And the second is a fairly sophisticated tool that we developed, HPC, and I say we. I'm not the developer of this tool, I'm speaking on behalf of the main developer, and probably means I'll struggle with the really technical questions, but I'll try and do my best. And this is a tool that we are no longer actively developing, although it's a lot on GitHub, and so there's some kind of lessons learned out of that that I'll go through. So, containers instead of custom software builds. We heard about this yesterday, right, where the traditional proper HPC way with the toothpick and GCC, where you go and build everything from scratch, use easy build, something like that, and it's pretty serious undertaking. The problem for us, we have this HPC system starting, it's a small system in the scheme of things, we don't have dozens of stuff. We basically have two sysadmins who also do training and a bunch of other things. Last time I looked, there's about 1,200 packages, different software versions and libraries and so forth. Not all of those are scientific packages, but there's the lint and meat libraries and so forth that have been created with easy build. Point being, there's a lot of moving parts and things to manage for a fairly small staff base. And even though we're a small facility, we get a lot of researchers coming in and more software packages being demanded, sometimes politely asked for, sometimes demanded every week, and it'll be something that's trivial and there's already an easy build script for it, or there'll be something really exotic and difficult to deal with. This is a problem for us because we are a small facility. We can only go so far without any staff, and they have other things to do. They're putting out fires, they're fixing infrastructure, they're trying to expand the system, keeping it going. There are better things to do than build one software package for one user that they may never end up using again. So, singularity, is it the answer to all of this? There's a little bit of skepticism, I guess, from the proper HPC people, and I've been trying to push this with our local facility and see if this is a way of taking care of this problem. So the question, I guess, is what to target with singularity versus building things from scratch. And these are the kind of things that I have in mind. So we had someone request a bit of software that needed a version of GCC that was 10 years old, something like that. And the admins were dead set against this, but really quite grumpy cat about it. Niche user bases. So there'll be the kind of classic HPC facility kind of software packages that are very commonly used and will be built from scratch still and highly optimized. But there's a stuff that only one researcher or one research group will use, and even then it might be they just want to test it and they'll never use it again. The admins are going to spend a week trying to build this thing. Horrendous dependency chains. You get this with scientific software, right, where it says, oh yeah, everything's in the make file, and we go and deal with it, and then turns out there's another 10 dependencies, and then those 10 dependencies have another 100 dependencies. Poor people who run the system get, you know, pretty stressed out pretty quickly, and this gets out of hand. The last one is they want it right now. Researchers, being researchers, they have time imperatives. They don't want to wait in the queue for software to be installed. As I said, sometimes it takes days, sometimes it takes weeks to get through, and they just want to get started straight away. So, what does it look like when we try this out and try to solve this problem with containers? So the first package that I kind of tried this out for is one called Digits. Has anyone heard of this one before? Played with Digits, a couple of people. So this is a package that NVIDIA published. It's a deep learning package for kind of image classification, principally. And it's a viral web interface, so it's kind of Python and then Cafe underneath that. This is really nice for researchers, and every researcher is now playing with deep learning, right? Who don't necessarily have a deep kind of coding background and just want to get started. So you can put your training data set into the web interface, upload things, kick off training jobs, and get going quite quickly. And so in this case, you're running an inference on a car there, and it's helping us into the Land Rover, which is pretty good. So the system admins laughed at me when I said I wanted to run this on the cluster, which means it's the perfect candidate for this. Cafe is somewhat tricky to build, it relies on GPUs, so there's kind of hyper dependencies there. And it has a web interface that you somehow have to pipe back out of the HPC system. And they don't have the idea of that either. So I tried to get this going in a container. And this was the first thing I ever run in Singularity. So this is where I just share my experience, I guess. So the first kind of thing I ran into is where you actually break this container, so, right? I mean, you don't need sudo to run this thing on the cluster, but you do need to break the thing in the first place. I have my MacBook. You can do Vega into the VMs and run Linux with it, and it's okay. It's one of the nicest stuff on the Mac. And what I ended up doing was using Anecto Research Cloud. So you just spin up a nice, clean Linux VM in the cloud, install Singularity on it, and then do things in that. And that's fairly straightforward to get going. Where it's nice when you get these Singularity images that are like multiple gigabytes, our research cloud, presuming you provision things in the right location, right availability zone, are in the same data center as an HPC facility, so we can actually break these Singularity containers that are multiple gigabytes, shift them over to the cluster, and then it takes seconds as opposed to yours on my laptop on the Wi-Fi connection or something like that. So that's pretty convenient. Also a barrier though, because researchers now have to learn HPC, they have to learn containers, and they now also have to learn this other tool, the research cloud. Creating the container in this case was really easy, thanks to the Docker reports I had. There's already a version that NVIDIA published for this. So it all seemed too easy at this point, suspiciously easy. So when you use GPUs for this to work, and this is where I stumbled a bit, it's gotten a lot easier now, but I scratched my head on this for a while. So the first naive approach was to go and just install the NVIDIA drivers. That didn't really work within the container. I found a script that the National Institutes of Health in the US published that it's quite a long bash script, but it calls in the NVIDIA drivers, unpacks them, does a bunch of symlinks, and magic happens or not, as the case may be. And that did work, but it wasn't portable. So we have K80 GPUs on our HPC machine. I wanted to move this container over to another machine for a benchmark, and that had P100 GPUs and different NVIDIA drivers. And I had to rebuild the container and put different NVIDIA drives in. So that's not very portable, that's not good. But then Singularity did this thing and replaced this day of work I did with this one flag. So you just put that in and it always magically works. So don't worry about it. The other thing that NVIDIA have been telling me about is this is a library that publishes currently in alpha status. And this is meant to be an API for container runtime to allow you to programmatically put a driver into a containment environment. I gather Singularity isn't looking at implementing this at the moment, but what I've gathered from the video is that this is going to be their official way going forward of doing GPU support in Docker containers. So we've got the container, we've got the GPU drivers, and it all seems to work. This is a Slurm script, might be familiar with it. Those of you who have used Slurm before. Have one node, all the CPUs on that node, request the GPUs, a 2-hour session, do some magic there with SSH and all the HTTP interface out of the cluster, so that you can just SSH in and use this thing via your browser and your local machine. And I guess the important part of this is this here, we're just keeping our singularity with this image here that I've created. Let me see my pointer, it's on the screen. So scroll. Finding in different directories. So this is now, it's meant to be a stateless container, we'll be importing Apple files or somewhere else. Chuck some environment variables in and then kick off digits. And that all worked and I was able to hand this to the researchers. They used it to benchmark against other systems that they were doing. And even though I was still learning singularity, this was probably faster than doing it all with a scratch build. So how do we do it? If there's an existing container available, it works really well. Complex builds are still complex. So after this, I was hoping to present another package called OpenCs, which was being used by a group of PhD students for earthquake modeling. And this was turning out to be difficult to install in a cluster. And I threw my hands up and had a laugh at the end and said, oh, I can make a run this container. But it was still hard. It was MPI, it didn't build, it was scientific software, everything was poorly documented, it was a nightmare, and so after a day or so I gave up. You know, having Ubuntu or some kind of fixed operating system kind of helps with some packages, but some things are still hard, it's not magic. Super users, I think, if we handed this to them, they'll be quite happy. They often build software on their own machine, they can still build it in a container and take along. My job is to interface with everyone else. I think I would struggle to articulate how to use this and get people on board if they weren't already at fairly sophisticated levels. That's a bit of a weakness. So that's the first part. The second thing I want to talk about is this project we did for C. Again, deciding I'm not the author of this, but I'll try and do it justice as best as I can. Again, the link is up there on GitHub if you want to browse through the source. So this was put together to serve kind of two use cases, and the first one was kind of the entry point, I guess, to get momentum. And we do software carpentry guest training in R, Python, MATLAB, natural language toolkit, it's like 3D slicer for medical imaging, all kinds of things. And we want people to focus on the training, start using the tools straight away, and not get bogged down too much with installing software on the local machines. And so can we provide a hosted service that will give people access to a wide variety of tools quickly without having a kind of barrier. And then the ultimate goal was to do pretty much along the lines of what we've all been talking about the last couple of days in an environment in a cloud where you can do your research, you can lock that down into a reproducible environment, you can share that, you can explore it, you can touch other patients. We didn't get very far away with that. The idea was to kind of start the training and expand into that. So the features of this, it's basically a service, a kind of microservice architecture that takes containers and runs them for you and presents them via a secure web interface. Any Docker container that has kind of a web interface, a Jupyter Notebook Studio, even things that have an X11 interface, so it'll kind of do an HTML via PNC interface, you can go and do things. And the interesting part is it's meant to be pretty agnostic about where the compute resources come from. They can be your local laptop, they can be in your local data center, they can be on a commercial cloud. And those resources make external connections to join into the scheduler and make themselves known. So again, I'll try and do justice to the architecture, keeping in mind it's fairly complicated. You have the browser, the router server. It's then kicking off sessions on compute nodes, and the important thing, I guess, is the compute nodes are making traffic outwards from where they're located. So you could conceivably have a compute node that's at home behind your ADSL firewall and still have it as part of this system, this network you can see. Going into even more detail, there's the notion of keeping track of the images, so it's got its own way of tracking images as they change, and the storage server here to basically make it so that you can mount volumes and other data sources into your containers so that you can use them and they're persistent. So you can persist either in the containers themselves or you can use a kind of external volume. I guess the thing to get across the philosophy of HPC is that the authors came along and said yes to every feature request that came along, and that means things got very, very complicated, and this is the kind of architecture you need to be able to do that. What I mean by that is that containers are meant to be just stateless things, right? We don't actually want to find them in situ, that would be very, very bad. But researchers want to do that, and so this is the kind of workflow patch that shirt to someone else, export it, and do whatever you want and modify it. And HPC will keep track of those changes. It'll sort them for you. It'll check some of them and keep them going and post them on your behalf. In terms of the front end for this is the kind of admin interface that you're dealing with. You can click off instances, for instance, the Python RStudio, that kind of thing. And you end up handing your URL to the trainees, for instance, and they go, okay, I'd like a Python session, please. The scheduler will go and find compute nodes that's allowed to use, go and run these sessions, boot up the container, print the web interface, which gets tunneled back via HPC and gets exposed to the user. All they see is something like this. So we're in HPC, click that button, and you can start using RStudio without installing anything else. But you can drop that down to the shell, and you have root access to break things or change things as you wish, and upload files into the container itself, and then of course you can assist those things if you want to. So the challenges of all this, in terms of for training purposes, we're now doing everything via the web, and that means you need good web connectivity. We have ubiquitous Wi-Fi on edge of Rome at the moment, even though I'm several thousand kilometers from home. But this wasn't always a given, unfortunately, that Wi-Fi would drop out, people's laptops it wasn't the absolute dependent on. The software carpentry thing was meant to be that everyone self-installed anyway, and it kind of came back to this title about the cloud. Either way, people are going to need to install on their local machines, and even if you're holding up the training by getting everyone on board with that, it's kind of have to be done anyway. I think that's probably the best. So it's kind of a philosophy thing of our cloud tools really appropriate for training. And the last one is that this isn't for free. There's a fairly complex system, and it actually needs hands-on DevOps and particularly the ops side to keep this thing running. The author of this package, Ken Dattrick, would actually be on call during training sessions, would provision compute services, make sure that those don't crash, and you would get new things like you'd have an instructor and they'd put a hand on the whiteboard and say, okay, everybody run this, and everybody gets into it at the same time, and bam, the remotes will get knocked down. It's quite hard to plan for this. It's not automatic, but it's scaling up and down. It does require a lot of hands-on support, and that makes it expensive as well. So none of the simplicity for the user is free on the other side of the coin. In terms of research, there are kind of only limited applications of this in the time that it was running. But the challenges, first thing, were the storage. If you have big data sets or data sets that aren't co-located with containers, keeping in mind we can put the containers wherever they want. That's hard to achieve in practice, right? Like researchers, they just want a shared folder, and it's on their desktop, it's on their HPC facility, it's in these containers, even though they're going to be all over the place, that's tricky to do. And trust is the other thing. They need to know that these containers are going to be reliable, they're not going to get corrupted, that they're going to be preserved in their path, and not going to be kind of interfered with the segregation between all the containers running on different nodes. I don't know how to solve this other than you just kind of push on for a long time until people So, in the end, we're still learning with containers, we're not the experts. I don't know how to target them. I don't know if they're forces that means if they're for power users or if the ecosystem is going to develop such that everyone can use them. If there's pre-baked images, we can just go Docker pool, singularity pool. I think it's brilliant, and I think half the trick will be having the community scale and things you can just have all those packages that are really well validated and you can use through a website. Very much looking forward to that. And I guess with the lesson of HPC, you can do anything. You can have these really complex architectures. It doesn't mean you should. I mean, just because containers themselves are a simple building complex for the absence of or around them can still be quite complicated. So that's about it. I'd just like to thank Tim Dattrick, and he's the principal author of HPC, so I'm kind of speaking on behalf of this project. And Alan is the project manager.